Ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards, welcome to the 21st edition.
21st, Dave.
Our podcast is now officially able to drink.
We're going to celebrate by drinking.
By drinking.
Yeah, and today I came up, I'm very proud of today's
drink. Wait, we didn't even say what it was.
Oh, yes, we did. We said Westeros Wheneverly.
Did we?
We did, yeah.
I don't think we did.
We did, we sang it.
Are you sure? Oh, okay.
Or maybe we didn't. Welcome to Westeros Wheneverly.
Wheneverly. We definitely didn't. That was weird.
Well, I don't know.
Well,
maybe this is setting the wrong tone for our podcast. We could go back and start it over again.
No.
We could do a take.
No. We do this live. Fuck it, we'll do it live. Just like our shots tonight, Tana.
Yeah,
which are?
Yeah, I was so excited. I wanted to jump right to doing the shots. So, for the first time ever, I think.
That's why we fucked up the beginning.
Yeah.
We didn't do our shot. Okay.
We haven't been drinking yet. That's the trouble.
That's the trouble.
The real problem here.
All right. So lay us on what this beautiful shot is, because it's concocted beautifully.
Thank you. I came up with it myself. It's called A Shot of Moon Blood. Today's episode is all about Azor Ahai, but it's also about moons, and so I came up with two drinks, Long Island iced moon tea, which obviously is just Long Island iced tea, but slightly modified.
Yep.
And then this one, which is I'm very excited to try it. Spoiler, it's going to be super gross if I did it right, and it's called Moon Blood, A Shot of Moon Blood.
So, I need to ask.
Yep.
When you were creating the shot, did you try it first?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I did not, and I thought to myself, I went to my creative center, and I said, okay, so we've got moon tea. There are two moons in, you know, the books that are sort of drink-related, or actually one isn't, but you've got moon tea, which is actually a thing inside the books, and then there's this idea of moon blood, which is a woman's first flowering, right?
Okay.
So it's attached to a woman's menses.
And that's what we're drinking?
And so I was like, what can I do that is going to have this sort of visceral, alchemical, like blood feeling?
Is this like a lesbian delicacy? It's like. It's
no,
like.
But it should be.
It's like, oh, baby, we're going to have some moon blood tonight.
So, to play along at home, you need a fresh, overripe strawberry.
I just want to let everyone know that it actually looks delicious and do not get turned off.
We'll post little pictures of it on our Facebook page, Tana Ford Designs, which is where we post all of our little pics.
Yeah.
And probably on Twitter, too.
We'll put it on Twitter and we'll probably put it on the website, which you probably already saw, hopefully.
It is a big strawberry, so a big ripe strawberry that you hollow out, and that's your shot cup. So we're going to be shooting this alcohol, which should be salty and sweet. Do you see where I'm going with this?
I saw where you went with that.
And in an edible shot cup, a red edible shot cup, so that we have to, the viscera and the like, the feeling of the fleshy strawberry are enough. So it's got, we'll just shoot it and then we'll see what we think.
Okay,
you're gonna want a napkin probably.
All right,
you gotta try to do it all in one, like, mouthful. So it's going to be a little bit like chewing.
Okay, so the object is we got to shoot this.
Yep.
Oh, and then while we're shooting it, shove the strawberry in my mouth and eat it? Or is this an all-in-one?
It's all in one. I want it, if you can do the whole thing as much, I don't know what your mouth capacity is, but you got to, it's big strawberry.
I mean, let's be honest, I'm quite loud and I have quite a large mouth, so.
And then, because I anticipate it being a little bit strong slash possibly gross.
All right.
Because the alcohols in here are.
We've got.
Tequila and gin. And a touch of triple sec to sweeten it.
I would have been okay with just tequila.
I know. Well, it's supposed to be very salty and very like, You know what I'm going for here, Dave. And then there's a salt rim around the top of the strawberry. The fleshy red strawberry. Are you ready?
Fuck it. Let's do it.
All men.
Must drink.
Here we go.
How do we cheers these? Oh, we don't? Okay.
That's awful. Oh, my God.
I think I put way too much salt on mine.
Oh, my God. That's so awful. But the strawberry is surprisingly sweet.
Yeah, the strawberry's not bad.
And it has that nice, like, It's very salty, right? Does it taste like blood?
It does not taste like blood.
Does it? Is it reminiscent of what you imagine menstrual blood?
No.
What it tastes like. This is why no. we have this podcast, Dave. We have to be willing to go that extra mile for our fans and do what others would not do.
Drink period blood? That's gross.
No, but like symbolic period blood, which is what this whole episode is about.
Okay, well.
The symbolism of A Song of Ice and Fire.
You know, I really didn't think that was too bad.
No?
I mean,
I liked it.
I mean, I wouldn't say it was my favorite shot. And I,
it might come back. There might be a ghost in there.
My aftertaste is quite strong.
That's why you have the...
That's why I have this little thing.
I put a mini strawberry that I cut in half on the tops of our open strawberries as a shooter, or as a chaser, so that you could end with the taste, the sweetness of the ripe strawberry.
That was much better. Yeah.
Instead of the salty tequila gin triple sec situation that we just had.
Ugh. Okay. Well, you know, we may see that at all the bars across America now.
Yep. Be sure to do it at your A Song of Ice and Fire themed
parties.
House parties, yeah.
That's right.
Yep. You could dip the bottoms of the fresh strawberries in dark chocolate and make them stand up. Like, there's a way of dipping them and then letting the chocolate dry so that the strawberry stands
up. Why didn't we do that?
Because, I mean, I work for a living, so I don't have an endless amount of time to come up with this shit.
Fine. That's a valid reason. I can't argue against that.
We can always use it. You know, maybe we do the chocolate strawberry cup in the future.
Can it be white chocolate, though?
Oh, that's a really good idea.
I like white chocolate a little bit better.
Maybe if we're doing an albino episode.
Are there albinos?
White and red. Well, sure, yeah. Blood Raven is albino.
Valid point.
Yeah, so maybe our Blood Raven episode, should we ever do one. If anybody out there in podcast land feels like borrowing that idea and wants to send us a picture of your strawberry and white chocolate shot cup on your Blood Raven podcast, please do. Hi, Susie.
I'll tell you what, though. That shot definitely makes your Long Island iced tea taste way better.
I followed the recipe on this, and it was awful.
It was terrible. All right, tell everyone what's in our moon teas.
Yep, so this is moon tea, and the idea behind this one is that, so in the story, moon tea isn't exactly tea. It is made to not have babies.
It's abortion drink.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's Plan B of Westeros. Yeah. And so it's like a tea that isn't a tea, right? It's actually a drink so you don't have kids.
Is there something you're not telling me?
I think if you drink these first, all night, the opposite might happen.
The opposite might happen, yeah.
But this has no iced tea in it, so it has the same idea, right? That, like, you combine all these ingredients together, and it's not tea, but it tastes like tea.
Okay.
And so it's our moon tea.
It's moon tea.
You just blend together lemon juice and a little bit of fresh lime squeeze. That's what we did. A tiny bit of triple sec, and then a half ounce of rum, very light rum, vodka, tequila, gin.
Maybe that was our problem. We used the private stock.
Soda.
It's not really a...
Yeah, the private stock maybe overtook. Yeah. And it's supposed to be made with all well alcohols and, like, shit alcohol.
Yeah.
So you drink these when you're in college or you're, like, unafraid to get wasted on shitty alcohol.
I think the first thing they teach you in bartending school is, like, if someone orders a Long Island iced tea, you should probably check their ID.
Yes, exactly.
Because
they're probably not experienced drinkers. They don't like the taste of alcohol, most likely.
Yep. And they're just trying to get fucking wasted.
Yeah, and that's going to get you
probably
twisted.
Underage.
Yeah, and so here we are being fancy again.
Uh-huh.
And fancy, you know, non-well alcohols. And we were too fancy.
We were too fancy. Yeah, we made it work in the end, which is the important part.
It is still a little...
Yeah.
It's not our best.
It's not our best, no.
But man, that shot.
What do you think was our best drink?
Oh, there's been a couple.
I'm not going to lie. Nedard 40 Hands, I think, so far has been my favorite.
That one was just so much fun to do.
Oh my God. That was like a game. It was like so. If I'm going to use a term that the kids use these days, it was so meta.
It's so meta.
Oh my God. Because it's like
meta.
A game within a game, within a Game of Thrones. Oh my God,
all
so
men
meta.
Must drink.
All men must drink.
Yeah. I liked it a lot.
Okay, Tana, so...
Yes?
Tell us what we're talking about in today's episode.
Yes, today we're going to talk about Azor, hell no, and all of our stuff. This is sort of a reactionary podcast. It's our second one. We did one on the Dragon Double X on Preston Jacobs' work. Well, we're doing it today on the excellent work of Lucifer Means Lightbringer, which if you guys in the fandom don't know about, do yourself a favor and check this guy out. He does a whole thing on symbolism inside of the Song of Ice and Fire series. And it, oh, hey, Susie. And where was I before I was getting attacked by our...
Lucifer Means Lightbringer.
Yeah, and he's just great. He only has three podcasts out as of right now. They're all about 2.5 hours long, which is great for me.
Very, very long.
Yeah, so if you drive for a living, if you like long analysis, but that's super on point, he backs up all his stuff. He does a very... He'll be everything that we're not, right? Sober, yeah. Like, on point. He doesn't really stray off topic.
From what I understand, he wrote... these essays, yep. Actually, and then decided to make them into a podcast series.
Yep. Yeah, he did an audio recording of an essay series, and they're fantastic, and it analyzes all of the symbolism, especially in the astrology aspect and in the mythology aspect inside the world of Ice and Fire, and his just work on it totally opened up some things that I want to talk to you about.
Okay.
So my goal is going to be to try to translate his brilliant analysis into lay people's terms or drunk people's terms and see if it holds water. See if it's the kind of theory that works with us.
I like it. I like this idea because it kind of reminds me of drunk history.
Yes, yes.
You
know,
where you take something very important.
We're the Westeros Wheneverly is the drunk history of A Song of Ice and Fire. Passionate.
You know, there's a Khaleesi and she went in the air and she said the dragons and they said no.
Cut to Dave vomiting in a waste paper basket. Just continue from the floor.
Yeah.
So to do that, I brought over my world map. And this is the
That's not surprising.
I know. I love it when we have episodes where I get to use my map. So we have the entire known world. So to play along at home, go to your internets or go to your own map that you own from the map book.
That you framed in a nice plexiglass. Glass frame that you can draw on and follow along with Miss Tana Ford.
Yeah, grab your little dry erase markers and let's go to town. So we're going to do a brief history, right, of evolution of species or something in Westeros, okay? Because you need to understand, in order for us to talk about this big calamity that Lucifer Means Lightbringer is talking about, we have to know what the world looked like. For instance, most specifically... 10,000 years ago, 12,000 years ago, the only creatures in Westeros were children of the forest and the giants. No mankind was over there at all. Mankind originates, if you're looking at your map, right here on the Sarn River. Sarni, S-A-R-N-E, whatever it is. But this is considered the center, it's pretty much the center of your map. If you're looking at the whole known world, from the Shivering Sea to the Summer Sea to the Sunset Sea.
Sounds like a song.
Yeah, this is like spot on in the middle. And so mankind originates here, and between, they estimate that man, the first men, marched over to Westeros across the Arm of Dorne, right, and then just spread northward. And so they started, these first men started waging war on the children of the forest and cutting down all of their weirwood trees between 12,000, 10,000, 12,000, 8,000, 10, 12,000 years ago, something like that. And so this is where the first men, like Ned Stark, his ancestors, everybody walked over across this land bridge, which is where the foot of Dorne is. You've got the stepstones. Well, that used to be a land bridge. And so for 4,000 years, human beings were walking across that by the thousands. And they got into wars with the children of the forest and with the giants. And because the men, mankind, had bronze weaponry, they were able to cut down all the trees that had faces. They went to war. Over here, in...
Parallel to very much like our world today, where we kind of just marched places and killed creatures. not giants. And
well, there's the giant's causeway over in Ireland. There, you know, it doesn't actually lead anywhere, but it's called the giant's causeway, as if it were, you could walk across Ireland to, I don't know, what's on the other side there?
I don't know.
Forgive me, all my Irish friends. But that it was a land bridge, that it led places, that you could walk across, you know, the world in a more Pangaea-like time in our world. But over here, we have some old, like the Giscari and the Carthene have been around forever and ever. So we've got Carth down here, which is in the, like, lower right-hand side of the known world. Now, Danny ends up in Carth. That's where the undead are, the House of the Undying.
Yep.
There's, right here, Carth is on the edge of what's called the Bone Mountains. And on the other side of the Bone Mountains are the plains of the Jogos Nai and the Grey Waste and places called Yi Ti. Now, Yi Ti has been around forever. And then we've got way over in the corner, the Shadowlands, and Ashai by the Shadow is in the very bottom right corner, almost falling off your world map, so far away from everything. But Ashai by the Shadow has been around forever. Carth has been around forever. And then Giscari, New Gis right here, and Old Gis, the Giscari Empire was also a thing. So we had our first men, and maybe even the Andals, originated over here in the center of the world and marched over. Hmm. Okay? Any questions, Dave?
No questions.
So, something happened in the lore that we understand, that the Children of the Forest were driven to a desperate act by the men who were cutting down all their trees and winning their war, that they called down a great calamity, and it shattered the arm of Dorne. Right, so now what exists there is just the stepstones. Mm-hmm. So it's like a broken thing, right?
So the children said, stop invading our land, and...
Yep. And so they called down a great calamity that turned the neck into a swamp, the neck right here into a swamp, and then, which is in like the center of Westeros, and then this, it broke up. They called up a great tidal flood, and it washed out and destroyed the foot of Dorne there, the bridge, the arm of Dorne, turning the arm of Dorne into the foot. So, Lucifer means Lightbringer, has said that based on ancient knowledge of the Carthene, who were around way back when, they talk about there being two moons in the sky, and that 8,000 years ago, the sun kissed the moon exploded, and a shower of meteors came down to the earth, and that's what caused the long night. And when you think about, and so that's the big idea, that 8,000 years ago, one moon gets hit by a comet and explodes.
And becomes two.
Sending thousands of meteors down to earth. I think it gets just destroyed, but I think there were two moons.
Oh, right.
So instead of like planet earth. So we've got one moon, and then little moon, probably the smaller moon, and the smaller moon gets exploded by this comet 8,000 years ago. Boom! And it rains down all these meteors, right? So the Dothraki and all sorts of cultures talk about the 1,000,000 flaming swords, the 1,000,000 horses in the Nightlands riding through the skies. The dragons burst forth from an egg. And so that's the big idea. And I had never considered that there might be two moons in the sky, and that a comet that came by 8,000 years ago and exploded one moon is coming back again at the beginning of our story on a collision course with the remaining moon. And so prophecies about Azor Ahai being reborn and all of this stuff are tied to this celestial action, to this body that's happening.
Okay.
Thoughts?
I think it's genius.
It really sort of, it's wonderful. Lucifer Means Lightbringer does a fantastic job explaining all of it too. Let me see. I want to play a couple of clips for you.
From?
So this is the two moon story.
Okay.
That Danny, we first hear about the two moons kissing or, you know, whatever, from early in Game of Thrones, like the first book. So if George has had this in mind, and it makes sense that he has, then it's been there from the very beginning. And so the scene is, Dany is in a tent with her three handmaidens. Two of them are Dothraki girls, and one of them is a Lycene, like, beautiful,
pleasure
blonde,
girl.
Yeah, pleasure yep. girl, mm-hmm. Daria. And it's Daria that's
who
telling
would
the
apparently
story.
Maybe like our shot.
Yeah.
Because it would remind her of, yep. you know, things.
The nethers. The lady nethers. So here we have Dany and the amazing Roy Dotrice.
A trader from Karth once told me that dragons came from the moon, Blondoria said as she warmed a towel over the fire. Jiqui and Iri were of an age with Dany. Dothraki girls taken as slaves when Drogo destroyed their father's Khalasar. Doria was older, almost 20. Magister Illyrio had found her in a pleasure house in Lice. Silvery wet hair tumbled over her eyes as Dany turned her head, curious. The moon? He told me the moon was an egg, Khaleesi, the Lycene girl said. Once there were two moons in the sky, but one wandered too close to the sun and cracked from the heat. A thousand dragons poured forth and drank the fire of the sun. That is why dragons breathe flame. One day the other moon will kiss the sun too, and then it will crack, and the dragons will return. The two Dothraki girls giggled and laughed. You are foolish, strawhead slave, Iri said. Moon is no egg. Moon is God. Woman, wife of sun. It is known.
You idiot.
It is known. Jiqui agreed.
It is known. Yeah, and so they just dismiss it as, like, foolishness. And so, of course, we don't know how clever George is being with us at this time, so we also dismiss it. And, like, I didn't, until this kid was, you know, hey, there's two moons, I never even paid attention.
Yeah.
But then there's fucking two moons everywhere. I have another clip that I'm going to play for you right now. Because if you go back and you look, an examination of the many folklores and stories across all the cultures of Westeros and Essos supports this idea, especially when you examine legends of the oldest cultures that still remain. We also have loads of references to the massive meteor shower that people would have seen from a moon exploding over the planet from all of these different cultures. Like I was saying, the Dothraki and their fiery steeds and the great Khalasar in the night sky, this could be a meteor shower. There are tons of these sorts of million fire, million dragon, flaming sword references. The R'hllor priests of the temple, it's in a lot of places, especially in Karth, Old Gis, and Ahai by the Shadow, where we know predate.
So it seems that, you know, you have the same story from multiple sources who probably at the time were not in necessarily communication with each other.
Exactly.
It kind of lends me to believe, you know, aliens, you know, as have you ever seen Ancient Aliens where they always talk? Yes?
No.
Well, there's a show on History Channel, and this guy, you know, it's always aliens. Like, you know, how do we have the same stories from multiple civilizations across the world when, you know, they have never communicated with each other?
Right.
It's a coincidence that, you know,
right.
and he goes directly to aliens, but, you know, like you said, yeah.
But if you've got a giant moon exploding, right? And so
you would assume everyone on the planet would see it.
Would see it, right? Yeah. You would see it. And if the thing that exploded it was a flaming comet, right? So comets are burning in the sky and they have big, I mean, the one that we're seeing now has a red tail.
Yeah.
But, you know, we don't know the color of the last one. But you've got this flaming sword, right? Like it looks like a sword in the sky hitting the moon and cracking it, right?
Yeah.
And from the moon, which gets destroyed, leaves a hole in the sky, you get all these thousand dragons, fire made flesh, flaming meteorites. Now, I have another thing. This is what Lucifer Means Lightbringer does so well. He has millions of these examples. I'm only going to use one more. But this is when Dany is going to. The eggs haven't hatched yet, so it's still early in Game of Thrones. and she's coming in to her tent, and it's very dark in her tent. And I want you to pay attention to, this is about a finger of light, a finger of red light touches one of the eggs. And I want you to just sort of be paying attention, listen for the finger of light, the comet, touching the dragon's egg, the moon, and bursting into 1,000,000 meteors. Just see if this holds up for you guys. Like, make up your own mind, obviously.
It was cool and dim beneath the silk. As she let the door flap close behind her, Danny saw a finger of dusty red light reach out to touch her dragon's eggs across the tent. For an instant, 1,000 droplets of scarlet flame swam before her eyes. She blinked, and they were gone. Stone, she told herself. They are only stone. Even Illyrio said so. The dragons are all dead. She put her palm against the black egg. Fingers spread gently across the curve of the shell. The stone was warm, almost hot. The sun, Danny whispered. The sun warmed them as they rode.
So we have the elements of sun and moon, meteors, or 1,000 flaming meteors, whatever she says, flaming lights. And dragons are stone, right? Like waking dragons from a stone,
right.
Could be another way of saying the moon exploded and this is where we got meteors. This is what, you know, this is connected to dragons. Questions?
My mind is slowly being blown at this, and so I'm a little speechless.
Yeah. So, so this is the thing that I want us to be able to talk about. This idea of there possibly being two moons, which before Lucifer Means Lightbringer, LML, came along, I had no idea it was even a possibility, and so I'm still chewing it over.
So, I mean,
yeah.
Thinking about our world, why is the moon important in our world? Well, it brings us the tides, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
So, without a moon, we would have very stagnant seas,
yeah.
I think, and that could cause huge issues.
With the seasons, maybe?
With the seasons, well, certainly, I think. It definitely affects, you know, currents and,
yeah.
and tides and stuff like that, so you wouldn't have these warming waters
yeah.
constantly moving around.
And if
so,
your planet was used to having two moons and you had stable seasons, and then one moon explodes, so for the next 8,000 years, you have really crazy long winters and summers and, you know, and the seasons are really thrown out of whack, but there's some runic record that they used to be more stable, then a moon disappearing from the sky would perhaps explain some of that.
Okay, so that definitely gives credence to all the stories we hear about some winters last, you know, 4 years,
yeah.
some winters last 2 years, and, you know, you're right, I absolutely just triggered that too. This is a different world, and maybe
yeah.
their seasons are
yeah,
different than ours.
It's magical,
but,
right? Like, we
right.
can't, we're not going to base this in real Earth science, but there's a magical component. So,
right.
you know, if Lucifer Means Lightbringer was saying, you know, 14 volcanoes all erupted at once, which was what happened in Old Valyria of the Doom, what would happen to the world? Probably every living thing on it would die, right? Like, we can't get too scientific, but except that there's a sort of, it's like a magical realism,
yeah.
right? So it could be that a magical comet ran into the moon. But so, okay, a comet explodes the moon. What happens?
Well, first things first, you have to be in a vicinity where the gravity, and I'm going all engineering.
Yeah,
right?
Do it.
The
we got to see if this holds up, man.
So, you know, a comet explodes the moon. The moon has to be close enough that the gravity of the Earth,
yep.
or planetos,
yep.
You know, sucks in all those
yep.
meteorites,
yep.
right? These fragments.
They go
of the
towards
moon.
the planet as opposed to out into space.
Well, I'm sure
some of them go.
I'm sure
space.
Some of them go out into space.
But you're thinking
you make,
some big pieces are going to fall to Earth, and some
I would,
pieces.
I would argue that yes, I would argue that there would be a bunch
yep.
that would fall towards Earth. Yes.
Well, is there any proof that giant chunks of the moon smashed into Planetos 8,000 years ago. What in the real world do we have?
Well, we have craters where meteorites and stuff have landed.
Isn't Great Crater Lake? That's not one. That's a that's a volcano. I have a thing. Go on.
I mean, I was going to say things like the Grand Canyon were obviously made by rivers, erosion, and over millions of years. But there are definitely, definitely craters.
Yep, like meteors that hit the Earth. There's one on the Idaho-Montana border called, hilariously, Beaverhead.
Beaverhead?
Which goes with our moon tea, moon blood shot.
Yeah, yeah.
And then in Siberia, I found a crater, a meteorite crater called Papagai.
Papagai?
Papagai.
Oh my god.
So they would leave big craters.
Yeah.
Do we have any, looking at our map, Dave, do we have any giant craters that we can see? You know, this is where sort of life started, but I'm going to just erase that. Any big craters?
I mean, I don't see...
I can see well, there's one. Here, yeah, what is... shrinking sea, but that might just be...
yeah, that topograph...
It's called a shrinking sea, so maybe that's just climate change.
Maybe that is climate change, but that definitely looks like a small valley in the middle of land.
This guy, the Great Sand Sea, that looks like a Grand Canyon.
Yeah, it could be a river that's probably eroded through...
Yeah.
So
over here, look, Womb of the World and Mother of Mountains. Right? Vase Dothrak. Where's
that
the Dothrak?
Does that go down? It's hard to tell on this map if that topography is coming up or...
So, what I remember is when they take Dany to see the Dosh Kaleen and they're in Vase Dothrak, she has to take a bath, like, after eating the horse heart. I think this all happens in Vase Dothrak. And they tell her that this lake has no bottom. This is a bottomless lake. And she, like, walks in and there's a bottom, right? Like, she's on the shore, and so she's like, there was a bottom. But if the lore is that it's a bottomless lake in the middle of a landlocked place, then I would say maybe this is where one of the meteors struck, and the Mother of Mountains could be where, you know, if it came in at an angle, it creates a hugely deep lake,
and then
pops up
the
Mother of
Mountains. Yeah.
Okay. So I think maybe Vase Dothrak and the Mother of Mountains is a spot. Then, we already talked about this one.
Yeah.
Fucking the Arm of Dorne.
Smashed to pieces.
Yeah, so, you know, let's say that a giant comet, which we're just going to draw on our board here, comes flaming down from
the
skies.
Looks like a sperm.
Yeah, it is. It's like, well, you know, procreation, right? Like, it birthed the egg hatched and out came dragons.
And it's going into a what looks like a vagina drawn on our board.
Kind of.
Well,
that looks like vagina dentata. Like, that's a toothy vagina.
Yeah, that's a don't stick in me or else you're going to get stuck. Anyway, okay.
So, if the children of the forest called down a meteor, which is what they take credit for.
Says, a giant calamity, right?
Yeah, to stop the men from coming, and it breaks the stepstones. Well, so let's say
Based on your drawing, they definitely already came.
Yeah.
So.
So let's say, we have a giant meteor that crashes into the Arm of Dorne and shatters it. What else would that cause? Giant tsunamis, right?
Yeah.
Tidal waves.
Tidal waves, absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
And so we have giant tidal waves. We have smashing into the earth here.
Which could very easily cause a flooding of the neck up top.
Well,
I think.
Or maybe something else hit the neck and turned it into a swamp. Maybe like another big chunk. You know?
Yeah.
Like maybe, so we have two big hits there. Oh, and this is the thing. The town right at the tip of Dorne, where this comet would have smashed in, is a city, the capital city of Dorne, which is called Sunspear. And if you're describing what a comet looks like, a sun spear, a flaming sword, smashes right there at your front door, and so your ancient city gets called Sunspear, in the same way that over here we have a place called Starfall, right? Which is where the Danes, House Dane has, right?
Okay.
What else do we have?
What else we got? So
page 8 of the World Book, a cataclysm forces a peace, quote, the inundation of the neck and the breaking of the Arm of Dorne, the great floods on Pike, that would follow, and the Iron Islands, cause the wisest of both races to meet on the Isle of Faces, right here, which is where Harrenhal is, right? But there's that little, like, island that Bran camps out in, I think. To meet and in the God's Eye to forge a peace. The first men agree to stop chopping down the weirwoods, and the children get to live in the deep forests and in the far north, along with the giants. And that's the peace. And once that happens, the Dawn Age ends, and the Age of Heroes begins. So that's our Westerosi ancient history.
Yeah.
And it ends with this cataclysm. The other and most important thing that happens, if these are all meteors hitting the world, smash, 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 and they're like half a dozen cities that have been destroyed, like that they're maybe, the theory that LML has is maybe they were hit like a shy by the shadow, these rotten shadowlands, maybe they were hit by a poison meteorite 8,000 years ago and it's made everything around it super toxic.
Radioactive or something along those lines. Yep. Yeah.
And so if that's the case,
definitely,
there are,
definitely a possibility. Yeah, there's a lot of radiation in space.
You can make a couple of cases for these areas of poisoning, you know, in different spots on Planetos could go if you're like compiling your evidence.
Okay.
But I think, you know, in Naga's teeth, right, we talked about the Iron Islands. She drowned whole islands in her wrath. So if a meteorite is like a dragon, right, flaming dragon, and it lands in the water and causes a tsunami, then that dragon
swallowing the whole island in its wrath. Absolutely.
And so we've got, you know, worldwide calamity, and what happens after this? It plunges the entire planet into a nuclear winter, because all that dust and debris and shit blocks out the sun.
And that would be the Long Night.
That happens across the whole world, not just in Westeros.
Right.
And so, you know, the Children of the Forest can't be that powerful. They've never, we've never seen them in our story be that powerful. And, you know, to cause down the Long Night and all this stuff. So it had to be a planet-wide catastrophe. And I think one moon exploding, along with the Carthine legend, kind of holds up.
So I agree. And my mind, again, I'm, this is the first time that I'm hearing this.
Yeah.
And so I'm a little speechless because I think it's amazing.
It's great, right?
And the amount of work that Mr. Lucifer means Lightbringer must have done get this
His stuff must have been incredible
amount of work. I'm surprised he is not a PhD, is he?
Yeah, I have no idea, but he's very, like, he speaks very well, like, his podcast is very well produced.
Yeah.
He's funny, like,
so
it's well
written.
He's everything we're not.
Okay.
I'm so glad we're doing a huge disservice to his brilliant idea.
Exactly. Anyway, but, so what is that?
All men must drink.
All men must drink.
You need a little more of our
fantastic. I'm almost out here.
Yep.
So the question now in my mind is, what does that mean for the existing moon?
Yep.
And is this comet that we see in the sky, you know, has it returned to finish the job of this of the moon that we have?
Yep.
And if so, what does that mean for Westeros? You know, or let alone Westeros, the Planetos, are we thinking, and this has just popped into my head, that George R. R. Martin is going
to blow up the world,
is going to pull a, you know,
nobody lives. I don't know, everyone's fighting about the Iron Throne.
Everyone's fighting about the Iron Throne. The others are going. There's a huge battle, and all of a sudden, like, the book just goes to black, like the end of The Sopranos.
No,
and you're like,
it's going to be like meteor hits King's Landing, meteor hits Old Town, meteors hit everywhere, flood everything, death and destruction.
Yeah, is this
fade to black?
Book 7 is just going to be at the very end, just going to be
pisses
like.
Pisses off the whole world and is like, just drops the mic.
Just like, you idiots waited over 14 years
for
this.
To find out who had the Iron Throne or who was going to win the Long Night.
Yeah.
Fuck all y'all. I think that would be a good way for him to go out. At least we see it coming.
At least, if anyone's, if you haven't heard it from anywhere, you heard it here first. All right, we're calling it.
Everyone dies.
Everyone is dead. The whole planet dies.
Nuclear winter, numero dos. But it explains why there was a long night across the planet, right?
Yeah.
It had to be some sort of giant cataclysm. And, you know, there are some proofs that these things happen. The other thing is, suddenly we have Valyrian steel longswords. And the chemical and whatever composition of meteorites has things like iron and tin or whatever. Like, there are metals that you would have to have advanced mining to uncover in the earth that would now just be landing all over the planet.
Yeah.
And if this is the material, let's say, that Valyrian steel swords are made of, if they're made of the moon meteors somehow, then it would explain a lot of, like, the sourcing and the specialness of this.
Yeah.
So, 100% it's something, agree maybe with that. Glass yeah. candles, it's called frozen fire is what obsidian is, you know, and it's thought to be, like, lava and stuff, but it could also be moon rocks. Lucifer Means Lightbringer does a way better job of explaining why that makes sense.
Yeah.
But
no, that absolutely makes sense.
So let's imagine, right, that the comet is coming back to destroy the moon. The other thing is his assertion is that the comet split and one part of it destroyed the moon and now it's coming back.
Okay.
And he sources this by saying that things like the sword ice, a Valyrian steel sword, has been split into two other swords, which swords and comets, flaming sword, comet, dragon, fire made flesh.
They're all symbolism of each other.
These are all symbols of the same thing. They can mean the same thing. And once you start seeing these symbolic patterns,
you never stop seeing them.
Yeah, every time it says, so pay attention, readers, listeners, every time you read 1,000,000 of something, look for references to comets, moons, stars in the sky, in absence. Like, a lot of times it's like the moon is absent. When there are 1,000,000 campfires, it's a moonless night because the moon disappears and the lights come out. Mm. And he's doing this over and over and over again to the point where it can't... Can it possibly be coincidence?
No.
No. Like, there's... It's just too good.
George is very, very good at hiding things in plain sight. And he's like, you idiots haven't figured this out.
Yeah. The only other thing, the womb of... So he did woke giants from the earth was another thing. That the children of the forest woke giants from the earth. That could just be earthquakes. You know, big rumbling when a giant meteor hits the ground. Woke giants from the earth. So I'm thinking giant ice spiders, but... Probably just earthquakes.
Giant ice spiders.
God, it's gonna be so scary.
Ooh, my voice is... My throat is destroyed.
So...
My apologies.
Now we're into what the actual podcast is about. Azor Ahai.
Okay.
Who is now, because of Lightbringer, Azor Ahell No.
Oh,
that's the name that I came up with. But basically, this guy... is a hero, question mark? How can that be true? Quote, it's after the description of the Long Night in the World Book on page 11 that we get our first description of Azor Ahai in the World Book.
In the history, okay.
Yep. It is also written that there are annals in the Inishai of such darkness and of such a hero who fought against it with a red sword. His deeds are said to have been performed before the rise of Valyria, in the earliest age, when Old Gis was first forming its empire. This legend has spread west from Ashai, and the followers of R'hllor claim that this hero was named Azor Ahai, and they prophesy his return. In the Jade Compendium, Kaloko Votar recounts a curious legend from Yi Ti, which states that the sun hid its face from the earth for a lifetime, ashamed at something that none could discover, and that disaster was only averted by the deeds of a woman with a monkey's tail. And now I'm going to play for you a clip by Salador San, read by the amazing Roy Detrees. I know some people don't like him, but I just think he does such a great fucking job.
And he's better than a fan.
Oh, he's better than any fan. Because listen to Salador San. He's like, he's this flamboyant Lyseni pirate.
Yeah.
And he just speaks, it's just wonderful.
So, for 30 days he's and 30 nights, Azor Ahai labored sleepless in the temple, forging a blade in the sacred fires. Heat and hammer and fold. Heat and hammer and fold. Oh, yes, until the sword was done. Yet when he plunged it into water to temper the steel, it burst asunder. Being a hero, it was not for him to shrug and go in search of excellent grapes such as these. So he began again. The second time, he took 50 days and 50 nights, and this sword seemed even finer than the first. Azor Ahai captured a lion to temper the blade by plunging it through the beast's red heart. But once more, the steel shattered and split. Great was his woe, and great was his sorrow then, for he knew what he must do. 100 days and 100 nights he labored on the third blade, and as it glowed white hot in the sacred fires, he summoned his wife. Nissa, Nissa, he said to her, for that was her name, bear your breast and know that I love you best of all that is in this world. She did this thing. Why, I cannot say. And Azor Ahai thrust the smoking sword to her living heart. It is said that her cry of anguish and ecstasy left a crack across the face of the moon. But her blood and her soul and her strength and her courage all went into the steel. Such is the tale of the forging of Lightbringer, the red sword of heroes.
And so, it's a really fucked up story. Like, that's not really romantic. It's really kind of shitty, and seen in a different light, you just murdered your wife for a sword. Right?
To A, you gotta make sacrifices to end the long night.
Yeah, maybe. And so here, a couple of things about this. Jon Snow has a copy of the Jade Compendium, right? Kaloko Votar's Jade Compendium, which is all about Azor Ahai, right? From Ahai by the Shadow. And Maester Aemon gives it to Jon, and it's not his dying wish, but it's his last thing that he ever says to Jon.
Read this
and understand it. So Maester Aemon knows that there's some secret, some important knowledge about Azor Ahai and the prophecies that he wants Jon to know in order to deal with Stannis and Melisandre and the Long Night and all this other business.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the last wish of Aemon Targaryen for Jon. First. Second, we have another tale, not of a hero, but of a villain that fits the same formula. The one from Yi Ti, which states that the sun hid its face from the earth for a lifetime, ashamed at something none could discover. And that disaster was only averted by the deeds of a woman with a monkey's tail. What if... So again, we have all these elements. A sun, a moon, a comet, a man, a woman, a sword, right?
What's the monkey's tail?
I'm thinking that maybe the monkey tail is like a comet tail, that it could be a reference to a comet.
Okay.
You know? So one is of a hero that saves the world from the long night, right? And then one is of the prophecy of that same hero's return, okay? Or his rebirth. In Yi Ti, the sun was ashamed, only to be saved by the deeds of a woman. In Ahai, the red sword was the hero sword, and he fought against the darkness with it. So I think we have the makings of a hero story and a villain story mixed up that are getting smushed together after so many centuries. I ask you, Dave.
Ask me.
Do we judge people by the company they keep?
Well, if you're asking me that question, I'd have to say yes, because I think I keep pretty awesome company.
And if you're friends with a bunch of douchebags, it looks bad on you.
It does.
Right? Like, it calls into question your character.
Yeah.
If you hang out with a bunch of a-holes, but people think you're pretty cool, something doesn't sit right.
Yeah.
So you would agree.
I would agree.
My question then is,
why are all my friends assholes? Oh. No,
who are Azor Ahai's number one fanboys?
Red Velour.
Red R'hllor. What do we know about Red R'hllor?
They burn the shit out of people.
They love burning people.
They love burning people.
They burn people alive all the time, including innocent kids.
Yeah.
Like Edric Storm that we had to, you know, send off on a boat.
And in the show, Stannis' daughter.
Yeah. So they fucking burn people alive. What else do they do? They birth horrible
demon monsters.
Murderous shadow babies.
Yeah.
That go and kill people. Right? Like, that's these guys. Those are these guys who are like, Azor Ahai is a superhero.
What you're saying is, they're pretty douchey people.
I think they might be douches.
Yeah.
The other thing about them is,
They also seem to spread and breathe hate for any other god that's not their own. They're like,
it's our way or the highway. Yeah. And by highway, we mean we're going to burn you alive.
Yeah.
Yep. It's, there's not a lot of tolerance here.
You know, it seems that the seven, the gods of seven, the seven-pointed star, and the old gods coexist.
I mean, Ned built a little sept for Catelyn to pray to the seven. It seemed like
it seemed like they coexist. There was... Yes, there's a little, you know, your gods are not my gods, but it's not like they're like, well, if you don't believe in our gods, we're going to kill you.
They're not tearing down the statues, the ancient statues of the Seven, and burning them in the streets.
Well, so what you're saying is the Red R'hllori are the Nazis.
I wouldn't say it like that, but I think they are, they're very questionable. They're, I don't think anyone's good or evil 100%, but I don't think burning children alive is going to win you a lot of points in my book.
I forget what the rule is, but there's a rule that if you let something go long enough on the internet, everyone will eventually bring up the Nazis and Hitler.
I'm glad we got there. Yeah. You know, got it out of the way early.
Got it out of the way early, yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh.
So,
51 minutes and 40 seconds in.
These guys,
oh my god.
The goal of Red R'hllor, right, and it doesn't matter really if it's Melisandre or Makoro or the other guy whose name begins with B, Bonaro, over in Volantis. They've all decided sort of that Dany is Azor Ahai reborn, and they gave their, you know, papal stamp of approval to her.
Right.
And they're gonna support her no matter what, right?
Yes.
Except for Melisandre, who thinks it's Stannis.
Right.
But what they want is to do two things. They want to wake fire-breathing monsters from stone.
Dragons.
Dragons. And they want to bring about a summer without end, which literally sounds like hell.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that would be a way to describe hell, I would think.
It's kind of like living in Florida.
Yeah, it's not... Oh, and they also idolize a man who murdered his wife to get a sword. Like, this is their hero, right? And so for those guys talking about their hero, I think maybe that makes this sort of questionable language, you know, puts it in a better light. My friend Davos can say it to us a little bit better. Okay, this is what Davos is thinking when he thinks about, he's, you know, Salador has just told him the story, and he's like, huh, what about that?
When he thought of Nyssa, it was his own Maria he pictured, a good-natured plump woman with sagging breasts and a kindly smile, the best woman in the world.
I love Davos.
He tried to picture himself driving a sword through her and shuddered. I am not made of the stuff of heroes, he decided. If that was the price of a magic sword, it was more than he cared to pay.
Davos is, like, the most decent dude in all of Westeros.
I think Davos is the true hero of our story.
I mean, and his devotion to Stannis is so awesome.
I mean, just the clip we saw of season 6.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, come on.
Apologies for what you're about to see.
Oh, my God.
I'm excited. This is our last podcast before the season starts.
This is
us. The last podcast. This is us. You know, untainted by the season 6 taint. We have not yet been touched by the taint of season 6.
Man, you really are loving the taint right now.
I'm going for it. I wondered if you picked up on it.
I pick up on it? Come on now.
I don't want to taint you with my opinion.
You will never, 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 ever, ever taint me with your opinion. No, I'm excited. I don't know what I'm going to do Sunday.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, I imagine you're going to watch it and freak out.
Well, yeah, that's probably... I'm going to have a huge boner while I'm watching it the whole time, I'm sure.
Like Archer, I don't know if I can drive this car with a raging erection.
Yeah, exactly.
Can I shoot this gun? Don't die on me, Dave. Don't die on me.
No, my throat has been bothering me, and I need to step alcohol, out for a second.
Alcohol so, kills germs.
Yeah, I know it does. But one second, ma'am. Oh, man. I can kind of breathe again. For those of you who don't know what just happened, I had a pause and go hawk up a loogie and shoot some Flonase into my nose.
Gross.
So that
thanks
I can maybe...
Thanks for walking us through that.
just wanted to walk you through it. I paused it so I spared you guys the agony of it.
Not me, though.
Yeah, but I decided to walk you through it anyway.
The Westeros Wheneverly, full immersion experience.
You know what?
That's all men must drink. All right. So let's see here. So we've got this guy, Azor Ahai, who stabs his wife through the heart, cracks the moon, and plunges the entire world into a night without end. Are these the actions of a hero, I ask you? Lucifer Means Lightbringer makes a good point that as above, so below. So if celestially a comet smashes into the moon,
yeah,
right? So the sun god kills the moon with a flaming sword, which is a comet,
mm-hmm.
then there should be a parallel down on Earth. And when we look to our world book, it tells us that in the land of Yi-T, there's the story of the Bloodstone Emperor, who was not a hero but a villain, who stole his sister's birthright, slew her, proclaimed himself emperor, practiced dark arts, tortured necromancy, feasted on human flesh, and quote, cast down the true gods to worship a black stone that had fallen from the sky. That's on page 301 of your world book. So we've got good and evil, light and dark, hero and villain. And we also have two ways of looking at the moon explosion. So this is like the theme of duality, right?
Yeah.
That we're seeing everywhere. We've got Azor Ahai, the last hero, the sword guy, with Nissa Nissa, and also Azor Ahai being reborn to wake dragons from the earth. Or dragons from the stone, you know, who's going to save us from the next long night. So Azor Ahai is two people.
Okay.
We've got two moons.
So
we've got a hero tale and a villain tale of the Bloodstone Emperor usurping his sister's, the Amethyst, which is purple, the purple empress's kingdom, all of which is explained in detail by Lucifer.
So how does this explain the others? How do the others fall into play here?
I wonder if they... Well, so I got... Well, maybe we should talk about that. Because are the others just creatures like the children of the forest are creatures and that giants are creatures? There's also in the world book they talk about a children of the forest-like creature over here on Essos near the Bones Mountains. On what we know now as the Dothraki Sea. So there's like a children-y-esque species there. So are the others part of this sort of, you know, mythical creature? Or are they from, you know, human hybrid others? These sort of undead blood magic, necromancy, Robert Strong business.
Okay.
People rising from the dead. We've got people rising from the dead with Red R'hllor. And that fiery kiss of light that brings Beric Dondarrion back to life and Cat, zombie Cat, back to life. There's got to be an ice and fire counterpart, right? Like, we've seen fire bring people back to life. And the book starts with whites,
right?
Which are ice magic bringing people back to life.
Okay.
And so we've got undead zombies on both fire and ice. And this is, after all, a song of ice and fire, which means... So you get the duality. So if there's two moons, it fits perfectly. Like, there's a nice snugness about the whole deal.
Maybe the first moon was the fire moon, and the second one is the ice moon.
The imagery of the moon talks about three characters always. The moon, the sun, and the comet.
Right.
Okay? And there's two specific ways of looking at this, both as a destruction story and as a procreation story. So you've got the Nissa Nissa is always the moon, the sun is Azor Ahai, and the comet is Lightbringer.
Okay.
So those are always our actors. The first story is about the forging of Lightbringer, and it concerns the murder or the willing sacrifice of Nissa Nissa, while the second story concerns Azor Ahai being, quote, reborn through the death of Nissa Nissa, a willing mother giving her life so that her child or children can live. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so we've got two distinct stories. interestingly, thinking on that sort of mother giving their life so that the little baby dragon meteors can be born. Jon Snow, Daenerys Targaryen, and Tyrion Lannister all have something in common. Two things in common. What are they?
Hold on. Repeat the peoples.
Jon Snow.
Yeah.
Daenerys Targaryen.
Mm-hmm.
And Tyrion Lannister all have two things in common.
They're all Targaryens.
Yes, that's true, actually. Though, at least as far as we believe.
Yeah.
Jon being the son of Rhaegar. And then Tyrion and Daenerys both being the children of Mad right. King Aerys. Dany also being the daughter of Rhaella.
Is that one of the two?
Yep, that's one of the two. Ooh. Oh, and...
Is this Stump Dave? Is this impromptu
this
Stump
is
Dave?
This is impromptu Stump Dave. So that's one. What's the other one? What's the thing about all of those people? When we're talking about a moon giving birth, think about it in terms of procreation.
Their mothers all died giving birth to them.
Ding, 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 ding! Dave!
Woohoo!
Hold on, I got a thing for this.
You got a thing?
Yeah, I do.
I love a thing. Whoa! Look at us, we're getting so high tech with sound effects.
30 minutes later. Hold on, I had a thing for this. Yeah, all of their moms die to give birth to them. And all of them fit within the archetype of Azor Ahai being reborn. Here to save us and wake stone dragons and blah, blah, blah. Right? So, let's see. I just put this note, as a child of both sun and moon, Azor Ahai that's reborn is also Nissa Nissa reborn. Like, let's not forget the mom in this. You know, yeah. Jon Snow is also Lyanna Stark, and
right.
Dany is also Rhaella, and, you know, yeah. Tyrion
There's
is
the
also
lesbian
Joy.
Coming out.
That's it, right? Like, this is the, let's get a little feminist up in here.
Up in this business.
Yeah. So my question for you is, do you think that Valyrian steel swords or glass candles are forged from these fallen meteorites?
Well, we took a really roundabout way to get there, but yeah. Yes, I agree. Yeah. I think I take that point and I put it on the board.
Now, what if Azor Ahai Sr.
Yeah.
didn't die? So we've got this story. I feel like I should have probably prepared a story about E.T., but I don't have one. But the story of the Bloodstone Emperor, what if that dude just never died?
And so, what? He's still lingering around?
What if he's the Great Other? What if he's the Great Other?
How would he get from Y'ti all the way to the north?
Well, I don't know, Dave. It was a long time. He did a lot of walking.
He did a lot of walking.
If our theory holds up, he's actually being trapped underneath Winterfell.
That's
so
true.
So he could be Azor Ahai being imprisoned there. Oh, and I have a thing about that. Maybe. I haven't actually... So this is the end of my notes. I don't have anything beyond this to present, so we're just going to, like, spitball.
We're
going to
wing it. Okay.
Yeah.
I love it. I like winging it. It's more fun for me.
I know, and I need to find the thing about Y'ti and what they say. That's the Dothraki. Because when they talk about the Bloodstone Emperor and his, like, super shitty behavior, his villainy, it's, I don't know, really something. Like, he's a super douche. It's on page 300. I need to get there.
Super douche?
He is. He's a super douche.
So he's like Hitler.
He is like Hitler.
We had to go back there. We just had to go back there.
Let's see. So we've got this. There's, in Y'ti, there's a lot of thousands of years of emperors, and they live forever and all this stuff, and it's everything is fine, right? When the daughter of the Opal Emperor succeeded her father as the Amethyst Empress, her envious younger brother cast her down and slew her, proclaiming himself the Bloodstone Emperor and beginning a reign of terror. He practiced dark arts, torture, necromancy, enslaved his people, took a tiger woman for his bride, feasted on human flesh, and cast down the true gods to worship a black stone that had fallen from the sky.
Meteor.
Exactly.
Yep.
And he slew his sister. What if his sister, right?
Nissa Nissa.
Like, Nissa Nissa. And if they were Valyrians or like some sort of Valyrian blood ancestor, then they could have been husband and wife as well as brother and sister.
Yeah.
And so it could be in Azor Ahai killing his wife, his sister wife, right?
Yeah.
And instead of like heroically doing it, he's stealing her kingdom, slaying her, and becoming a necromancing, black arts practicing, bloodstone worshipping
yeah.
usurper.
And maybe the Red Valorians are the descendants of this.
Yeah, because Azor Ahai.
Of this history afterwards, because, you know, whoever wins wars or becomes a ruler writes their own history. Yep. So while the legend of Yi Ti may describe the truth,
yep.
you know, he may have changed it for the future.
The thing on The Long Night, the last hero, doesn't he collect his friends and, like, start, you know, he gets, like, warriors around him. Right? So maybe the Rolorists, the original Rolorists, are his first servants. Although it does say this. Many scholars count the Bloodstone Emperor as the first high priest of the sinister Church of Starry Wisdom, which persists to this day in many ports throughout the known world. And there is a Starry Wisdom place in Bravos. That Arya talks about, but, like, whatever, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
In the annals of the Further East, it was the Blood Betrayal, as his usurpation is named, that ushered in the Age of Darkness called the Long Night. Despairing of the evil that had been unleashed on the Earth, the Maiden Made of Light, maybe the Sun, turned her back upon the world, and the Lion of Night, the Long Night, came forth in all his wrath to punish the wickedness of men. And so, in all of these tales, the Long Night follows this act of betrayal.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we've got meteors smashing into the earth, which is the real world, as above, so below. And then we also have this usurpation tale throughout the annals. And maybe things are getting a little mixed up, because we've got
10,000 years of
How long the darkness endured, no man can say, but all agree that it was only when a great warrior, known variously as Harkun the Hero, Azor Ahai, Yin Tar, Nefarian, and Eldritch Shadow Chaser, arose to give courage to the race of men and lead the virtuous into battle with his blazing sword, Lightbringer, that the darkness was put to rout and light and love returned to the world once more.
So regardless of what people call him, they all agree that he had Lightbringer.
Yeah. Yeah. They all agree that he had a flaming sword of heroes. And, you know, if he's fighting others, as we know, a flaming sword would be really, really useful. The only name that doesn't fit, so there's a Kingdom of Harkun. So there's one guy called Harkun the Hero. Then there's Azor Ahai from Ashai.
Right.
Then Yin Tar is probably the name that Yin Ti came up with for their version of the hero. Nefarian, I don't know where that would be from, but maybe Karth, Olgis, Volantis.
I know there's
Nefarian.
Nefarian in World of Warcraft is a very...
What is it?
A powerful dragon.
Mm.
He's a very powerful kind of like dragon king.
Nice.
Nefarious.
I like
it. So,
and then the only one
some
that
lore there behind
that doesn't
that
fit is Eldritch Shadow Chaser. Eldritch is very much a Westerosi name.
Yes, that's a first man's name.
Yeah. And Shadow Chaser, like that's an Age of Heroes kind of name. So maybe that's what the name of the last hero was, Eldritch Shadow Chaser.
If it was Shadow Birther, I could say Valorian.
But if he's Shadow Chaser, so he's chasing...
away the shadows from the Red Valorians.
I wonder if we're going to have like a father... So if Azor Ahai original isn't dead, right, if he's like the great other, which I don't know where this is coming. Like, LML doesn't make any of these crack pottery. Like, now we're just going into some crack pottery stuff. But if he's still alive, and then the son or daughter reborn has to go kill him, you know, that seems like part of the story.
Yeah.
You know?
I agree.
So, to that end, I think I have a thing on it. When I was looking up for all of the, trying to get, like, audio clips for today's show, I found this awesome one on John.
Tana, I love that you have a thing for everything.
I have a thing for this.
It makes me so happy.
I have a thing for this. So this one's called Jon Snow's Crypt's Dream. Him and Sam are like totally broing out and like sharing their deepest fears and loves with each other or whatever.
I was so scared that my father wanted me to be a man.
And he's like, oh, well, you can't. I'm going to kill you with my own sword.
Yep.
So John is telling him about his dream of the crypt. And I want you to pay attention to what John says. And that who it is that he's looking for in this abandoned castle. Okay?
All right.
It seemed 1,000 years ago now. Before long, he found himself talking of Winterfell. Sometimes I dream about it, he said. I'm walking down this long, empty hall. My voice echoes all around, but no one answers. So I walk faster, opening doors, shouting names. I don't even know who I'm looking for. Most nights, it's my father. But sometimes it's Rob instead, or my little sister Aria, or my uncle. The thought of Benjamin Stark saddened him. His uncle was still missing. The old bear had sent out rangers in search of him. Sir Jeremy Riker had led two sweeps, and Quarren Halfhand had gone forth from the Shadow Tower, but they found nothing aside from a few blazes in the trees that his uncle had left to mark his way. In the stony highlands to the northwest, the mark stopped abruptly, and all trace of Ben Stark vanished. Do you ever find anyone in your dream? Sam asked. John shook his head. No one. The castle is always empty. He never told anyone of the dream, and he did not understand why he was telling Sam now. It somehow, it felt good to talk of it. Even the ravens have gone from the rookery. And the stables are full of bones. That always scares me. I start to run then, throwing open doors, climbing the tower three steps at a time, screaming for someone, for anyone. And then I find myself in front of the door to the crypts. It's black inside. I can see the steps spiraling down. Somehow I know I have to go down there. But I don't want to. I'm afraid of what might be waiting for me. The old kings of winter are down there, sitting on their thrones with stone walls at their feet and iron swords across their laps. But it's not them I'm afraid of. I scream that I'm not a Stark, that this isn't my place, but it's no good. I have to go anywhere. So I start down, feeling the walls as I descend, with no torch to light the way. It gets darker and darker until I want to scream. He stopped, frowning, embarrassed. That's when I always wake. His skin, cold and clammy, shivering in the darkness of his cell, ghosts would leap up beside him, his warmth as comforting as daybreak. He would go back to sleep with his face pressed into the dire wolf's shaggy white fur.
How awesome is that?
That's,
he's looking for his father. Well, of course we're thinking Ned.
Yeah.
He's probably thinking Ned. But who's his real dad?
Rhaegar.
Rhaegar fucking Targaryen. And he has to go into where the Stark, it's a Stark place. And I don't belong there, he says. This isn't my place. But he thinks it's because he's a bastard.
Yeah.
I'm a bastard. But it's really because he's a fucking Targaryen. But the Kings of Winter aren't what scare him.
Right.
It's the thing that they're protecting. It's that other thing in the darkness.
It's that thing that's buried under Winterfell, which you have to listen to
yes!
our Winterfell
episode
to hear about it. And on that bombshell, to steal a quote from Jeremy Clarkson.
I love it. I don't know.
That is our episode.
Yeah. What do you think, man? Oh, and I have a thing.
My mind is still kind of wrapping around the whole science-y meteor of this world. I am going to go listen to all
if you have eight
6 hours,
if you have 2.5 hour clips, whatever that adds up to.
Yeah.
Then,
damn.
It's so great. He gets into all of the actual symbolism. He talks about Mithros or, like, a lot of George's influences that George has talked about, and he talks about, the Bloodstone, what an actual Bloodstone is, that there is an actual thing called Bloodstone, and it looks like blood has dripped into it, and they say that's what Jesus bled on, but it's really a thing. Maybe heliotrope is the name of it.
Mm.
And it's just awesome. This guy has done such a thorough and beautiful analysis of the symbolism that I'm sure we haven't convinced you, but maybe we've sparked your interest. Go listen to Lucifer Means Lightbringer.
And where can they find Mr. Lucifer's? Just Google Lucifer
Means Lightbringer. Yeah, Lucifer Means Lightbringer at wordpress.com or org. Maybe, I don't know what his thing is, but we'll have a link to it if you're on our Westeros Wheneverly at Podbean.
Lori.podbean.com.
That's the one. Then we'll have a link there for you to go check out, or just Google Lucifer meets Lightbringer, and the first one is like the astronomy of ice and fire, so you'll know what it is. And it's very, very well done, very compelling stuff. And let's see.
And you can find, you can email us at westeroswheneverly@gmail.com. You can follow us at WarriW4RRI or at Tana4. Yep.
Oh, I have Silk coming out tomorrow. Silk number 7, I want to say.
Excellent.
And it is the third installment of the Giant Spider Women crossover.
This is why you're obsessed with giant ice spiders, I think.
No, this is like rehabilitating my fear of spiders.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm trying to see them as like empowered and not creatures of terror.
My friend told me the other day that he killed a brown recluse.
That's terrifying.
Yeah, I know. Because a brown recluse, if it bites you, will rot your arm.
It necrozes your entire thing. But there is one, there's a fiddleback spider that is a brown recluse lookalike that isn't poisonous. And so if you have the chance, if you ever get bit, save the corpse of your spider if you can, so it can be analyzed and people can help you. There's actually an artist, I follow his stuff, he runs a site called, I don't know how to pronounce it, Topatico. So it's like potato, but Topatoco.
Okay.
And he got bit, and he's done a bunch of web comics on his brown recluse spider bite. It necrozed like a giant chunk of his shin.
Ooh.
Yeah, and so he has like a huge scar there, and it's all chronicled.
But
so
he survived.
Like, well, yeah, he survived. So, and I was good. Like, that's terrifying and awful. So, spiders, go pick up Silk, number 7 tomorrow. You should be reading the Silk crossover, or the Spider-Women crossover event. It's very exciting and very well done. My friend Bengal, a French artist, is doing the Spider-Gwen versions, and he's doing a killer job. It's so great. So, do that. That comes out tomorrow, which is Wednesday. What else, Dave?
I think that's it.
Do you think that there's going to be an Azor Ahai, the first hero, fighting Azor Ahai Reborn? Is that too crackpot?
I definitely don't think that Azor Ahai is immortal, right? I think there's probably a symbolism of Azor Ahai. And
what
maybe,
about, what do you think the Great Other is?
Well, and that's what I'm saying. Maybe the Great Other is the symbolism of Azor Ahai. Or,
you know,
I think definitely the Great Other, I think, is the 13th.
Lord Commander, Knight's King.
Knight's King. I think that theory holds.
I have to watch the show, right? Because they pretty much show Knight's King, right? Like, they show a Great Other, don't they?
Yeah, they do.
In the book, we don't even know anything about them. And Cold Hands, from fan analysis, it's not him.
What?
Yeah, a lot of people, can I spoil some stuff? So jump off now.
Of course you can.
There's some fan theory that the others have a whole other city, and they're a civilization that has, like, I don't know, coffee shops or something, but they have taken him prisoner because of his king's blood, his old king.
What are they doing with the babies then?
I don't know, raising them?
No.
I think they raised them in this city. Well, that's what people say. And that Cold
Hands. Do they have
proof
to this?
I don't know. Go to Reddit or wherever people go.
I don't know.
But people think that Cold Hands is an old, like, he's too old to be Benjen Stark. He's been dead for a long time. The tree doesn't mean that he's been dead for a month. He means that he's been dead for a century. Mm. Or 8. Or something. So I don't know, but maybe Benjen's alive. And we keep being reminded that Benjen disappeared and we don't know where he is. So people think that he's being held prisoner by these others. The sophisticated, shimmery, magic cold sword.
Maybe Cold Hands is Dunk.
Maybe. Oh no! No, I refuse to believe that. Dunk died.
Yeah.
He died. He killed.
And Blood Raven couldn't bring him back? I mean, come on. Blood Raven knows Dunk.
You know, Dunk didn't know his mother. I bet. Maybe he did. He must have known his mother. Brienne didn't know her mother. I'm not saying she's Azor Ahai, but she, quote, says that she never knew her mother. I have a thing I just wanted to say to you, so we'll go, like, we can be done. But I have a cool thing that goes with ice zombies.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. It's
right
here.
So should I turn this podcast off, or should I let people keep listening to our thing about ice zombies?
This is a good one for people to think about. So it's like a
paragraph. Lay on me the cool thing about ice
World
zombies.
World Book, page 294. I found this, and I haven't heard anybody talking about this, and I feel like it's pretty straightforward. This is the exact quote from the World Book.
Listeners, this is for you.
Yeah, listeners. If you know more about this, which you, whatever. If you do, it's great. It's also just something to think about because, spoilers, ice dragons. Quote, of all the queer and fabulous denizens of the Shivering Sea, however, the greatest are the ice dragons. These colossal beasts, many times larger than the dragons of Valyria, are said to be made of living ice, with eyes of pale blue crystal and vast translucent wings through which the moon and stars can be glimpsed as they wheel across the sky. Whereas the common dragons, if any dragon can truly be said to be common, breathe flame, ice dragons supposedly breathe cold, a chill so terrible that it can freeze a man solid in half a heartbeat. Sailors from half a hundred nations have glimpsed these beasts over the centuries, so mayhaps there is some truth behind the tales. Archmaester Margate has suggested that many of the legends of the North, freezing mists, ice ships, Cannibal Bay, and the like, can be explained as a distorted report of ice dragon activity. Though an amusing notion and not without a certain elegance, this remains the purest conjecture, as ice dragons supposedly melt when slain. No actual proof of their existence has ever been found. Motherfucking ice dragons, Dave.
I think they're in the city with the others, maybe. Like, you know, in the ice coffee shops, you know, doing something.
They have to have, like, armors, making every other, like, fancy steel-shattering swords or whatever, so...
Well, ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards, this has been in a wonderful episode, exploration of a scientifically filled episode, and then ice dragons thrown at the end.
And then ice dragons.
So,
punctuated by ice dragons.
So thank you for listening.
Yeah, thank you for listening.
And make sure that you all have as much fun listening to Lightbringer.
He's so good.
Tana did, and also make sure you drink delicious drinks and continue
bloody moon blood.
Have to remind them of that. Okay, and the moon blood.
Salty, sweet.
Anyway,
Menzies shots.
We'll leave you with the Menzies shots, and just remember, ladies and gentlemen, all men
must drink.